Overclocking Ryzen 3 is a straightforward process, but there are some important things you don't want to forget. Howdy howdy guys, Ponchado here, and today I'm going to walk you through, step by step, how to overclock AMD's Ryzen 3 processors and memory. I should say up front that overclocking does carry some risk of damaging your parts. There's no way around that, but for the most part, you'd have to go pretty far out of your way to actually permanently mess something up. Most components these days have built-in thermal limits that will throttle or shut down the computer before something gets damaged. Step 1. Gather your tools. You'll need 5 pieces of software to monitor your processor speeds and temperatures, stress test, and check stability. First on the list is a program called HWMonitor, which stands for Hardware Monitor. This program shows you all of the sensor data it can find on your PC, everything from motherboard voltages to GPU fan speed. What we'll be focused on, however, is the CPU temperature. This is really the most important metric you need to pay attention to while overclocking, because if something does get fried, it will almost certainly happen because of a temperature problem. We'll also use Hardware Monitor to keep track of CPU clock speeds and utilization. Next is CPU-Z, another monitoring program. CPU-Z gives you very in-depth information on your processor: TDP, instruction set, cache data. The parts we'll be focusing on are core voltage and the core speed and multiplier. Hardware Monitor shows core voltage as well, but it was always a bit off of what I set in BIOS. CPU-Z seems to be more accurate. The other tab we'll look at in CPU-Z is the memory tab. This is where we'll verify that the memory overclock actually got applied. The third program we'll use is Prime95. This is a simple CPU stress test that works by using your processor to calculate prime numbers, which does a great job of heating it up. The reason we use this is to make sure that the CPU temperature is always safe. Prime95 will stress your processor more than probably 99% of any load you'll throw at it in the real world, so it gives you a pretty accurate view of worst case temperatures. The fourth program is for stability testing, IntelBurnTest. At the most basic level, this program calculates a math problem and spits out a result. By running the test 5, 10, or 20 times, you can verify that the processor isn't making mistakes, aka unstable, because the result will be the same each time. This program uses the same stress test called LINPACK, which Intel uses to verify its processors in the factory. The last program is very appropriately called memtest. It tests memory. Memtest is, in my opinion, the best way to test memory stability because you can do it from inside Windows. There's another memory tester called Memtest 86, but this requires making a bootable USB drive, and I just prefer staying in Windows since it's easier. What Memtest does is write patterns to your RAM and then reads those patterns to check for errors. If it finds any, it'll give you a warning message and notify you. Download links to all these programs are available in the description. They're all free, they're all tiny, and they're all portable. I just have them on a USB drive for whenever I need to test a computer. Step 1.5, update your BIOS. Okay, so I lied in the title. It actually may be 4 steps if you run into problems and need to update your BIOS. Ryzen motherboards had a lot of compatibility problems in the beginning, particularly with memory. Fortunately, most of them have been fixed by now, but it still means you may need to update your BIOS if you're having issues. On my MSI B350M Gaming Pro, the motherboard I used in my little red build, there was a glitch when overclocking processors. When you manually set the voltage, it would lock the multiplier to 15.5, which corresponds to a 1.55 GHz clock speed. It took a long time to find the fix because MSI's website sucks and they only posted it on their forums. Who does that? Anyway, to fix that issue, you'll need to update to the latest beta BIOS, which isn't linked to on the actual B350M Gaming Pro page. It's buried in their forums. A link to that is in the description below. Once you have the latest BIOS for your motherboard, put it on a USB drive and reboot the computer. To get into BIOS, at least on most MSI motherboards, keep tapping the delete key on your keyboard. Some motherboards may use the F1, F2, or F8 keys as well. If it worked, you should see a screen that looks something like this. To update your BIOS, click on mFlash, or your motherboard manufacturer's equivalent BIOS flashing option, and this will bring you to the Flash menu. Make sure your USB drive is still plugged in, and then use the file browser to find the BIOS update file. For the MSI B350M Gaming Pro, the beta BIOS file I used was called E7A39AMS.283. Those last three digits, 283, stand for version 2.83, the most recent available as of August 9th, 2017. Hit enter to select the BIOS file, make sure it's the correct one, and then enter again to start the flash process. It may take up to a few minutes to flash the BIOS. Once it's done, the computer will reboot and you can start clicking the delete key again to enter BIOS. Once you're back in BIOS after updating, check that you actually are running the latest version. This may be buried in the menus on some motherboards, but on mine, the BIOS version is displayed right at the top of the screen. Version 2.83, just like we wanted. Step 2. Overclock. Surely I'm oversimplifying, one does not just overclock. Actually, that's about it these days. Enter your motherboard's advanced mode by clicking the button at the top of the screen, or F7 at least for MSI boards, go to the OC menu, and you have every option you'll need. It looks a bit daunting at first, but there are really only four options you need to pay attention to: CPU ratio, DRAM frequency, CPU core voltage, and DRAM voltage. CPU ratio is how the motherboard sets the CPU clock speed. It does this by multiplying the base clock, 100 MHz in pretty much every case, by the CPU ratio. Put in 31 and you get 31 times 100 MHz, or 3.1 GHz. Type in 40 and that puts the CPU at 4 GHz, and so on. DRAM frequency is as it sounds, you just click it to enter the menu and select your speed. CPU core voltage and DRAM voltage are, likewise, self-explanatory. The best way to overclock is to first tweak the CPU and verify that it's stable, then overclock the memory and verify its stability. You really only want to be testing one component at a time, otherwise it's much harder to narrow down what's causing the problem. A good starting point is to set the Ryzen 3 1200 to 3.8 GHz. You can do this by typing 38 in the CPU ratio box and clicking enter. The vast majority of Ryzen 3s should be able to reach this speed, even on stock voltage. However, to get the best overclock and maximum stability, you'll need to turn the voltage up. Many people run at 1.35 volts, and AMD says that up to 1.4 volts is safe with adequate cooling, but I recommend just starting at 1.3 volts because the Ryzen 3 stock cooler isn't super strong. Do this by selecting the core voltage entry and either typing in 1.3 or clicking the plus key on your keyboard until it's at 1.3 volts, then hit enter to confirm. That's actually it. You can just click the X at the top right or go through the menus to save changes and exit. The computer will reboot and your updated clock speeds and voltages will be applied. For overclocking memory, the process is almost identical. Click on DRAM frequency and select whatever speed you want to test. Most DDR4 2400 modules should be able to hit 2667 MHz, though I hit the silicon lottery and mine are stable at 2933. With faster modules, you may be able to hit 3066, 3200, or even higher than that. Click the speed you want, and then move down to DRAM voltage. I run mine at 1.35 volts, and most people run theirs at 1.35 volts, so I'd recommend starting there. If you have RAM fitted with fancy heatsinks or rated for high speeds like DDR4 3200 or above, you can probably safely run your memory at around 1.4 volts. If you don't care too much about longevity or practicality, AMD says you can run memory up to 1.5 volts. I probably wouldn't do this unless I had RAM with a fan directly on the DIMMs. Once you have your preferred frequency and voltage, save changes, exit BIOS, and the computer will reboot. Before I move on to verifying and testing in Windows, what if your computer reboots and you just get a blank screen? Don't worry, all you have to do is clear the CMOS. That's where your BIOS settings, including increased clock speeds and voltages, are stored. Just about every motherboard will have a clear CMOS jumper. These are two pins on the motherboard that you short together for a few seconds to clear memory. Most Ryzen boards require that the computer be turned off but still plugged in to clear CMOS. For the MSI B350M Gaming Pro, the pins are located just forward of the PCIe x16 slot. If you don't have a jumper available, you can use a metal screwdriver or paperclip to short the pins together. Hold it for 5 to 10 seconds, and the CMOS should be cleared. If you have a different motherboard, check the manual for any special instructions. Once you clear the CMOS, your motherboard will load all default clocks and voltages. Some motherboards may be aware of a cleared CMOS, and instead of booting straight to Windows, it'll give you a screen like this. This makes it easy to either enter BIOS again, load the default settings, or load an overclocking profile you saved previously. If your computer failed to boot, you'll need to enter BIOS again and either reduce your clock speed or increase your voltage. If you're running a Ryzen 3 with a stock Wraith Stealth cooler, I really wouldn't recommend pushing it past 1.35 volts to keep it at a safe temperature. My first move would be to lower the clock speed to 3.7 GHz or so and try again. Once your computer successfully boots to Windows, it's time to start testing. Step 3. Stress, test, and repeat. This is the part of the process that takes the longest, especially if you're trying to squeeze out every last bit of performance from your chip. The easy way to overclock is to just OC your Ryzen 3 to 3.8 GHz, verify stability, and leave it. If you want to eke out that last little bit of performance, for example to hit 4 GHz, you'll have to repeat this process a few times, bumping up clocks and playing with voltages in small increments. We'll be using all the software I introduced in the beginning of this video. The first two programs, Hardware Monitor and CPU-Z, should pretty much always be open so that you can verify everything's running at the correct speed and within safe temperatures. First, we'll cover CPU temperatures and stability. The first thing we'll do is check that temperatures are safe. At idle, your processor should be sitting somewhere below 45 to 50 degrees. AMD specifies a maximum temperature of 95 degrees Celsius for Ryzen 3 processors, but to be 100% safe, I would recommend staying below 80 or, even better, 75. To stress your CPU and bring up the temperature as much as possible, we'll run Prime 95. When the program loads, you should have a small Run a Torture Test window. Make sure Small FFTs is selected for maximum heat generation, then click OK. The program will start running a stress test and your processor should start heating up. Keep a close eye on the temperatures in Hardware Monitor. If it goes above 75 in the first few seconds, you'll need to lower speeds or voltages to reduce heat. Let Prime 95 run for 3 to 5 minutes for temperatures to stabilize. If your processor doesn't go above 75 degrees, then your overclock is safe, at least thermally. Once you're satisfied with the temperatures, click Test on the Prime 95 window and then click Stop. This will stop the stress test, and then you can click Exit. The second step of the process is to verify CPU stability with IntelBurnTest. The good news is it has a super simple interface. There are really only two things you need to interact with. First, times to run is the number of runs it'll do of the stability test. 5 is the bare minimum to call an overclock reasonably stable, though for the final overclock you'll want to run the test 20 times to be 100% sure that it's stable. Each run takes roughly 30 seconds to perform. Put in how many runs you want to use, I'd recommend setting it to 5 while you're still making rough adjustments, and then click Start. Your computer may be a little unresponsive while it's running, so just let it do its thing. As it finishes each run, it'll report a number in the results column. This number should be the same for every run. If any of them are different, that indicates calculation errors and the overclock is not stable. If you make it through each run without any errors, your overclock is reasonably stable and you can go back into BIOS to overclock further. I would do it in steps of 100 MHz. Bump up the clock speed, test the temperature with Prime 95, then verify stability with IntelBurnTest. Once you can't increase speeds any further, you can either leave that as your final overclock or increase your voltage by 100 millivolts, or whatever the smallest step is, and try to go faster. Be sure to carefully monitor temperatures if you increase your voltage. Once you're happy with your overclock, you can move on to the memory. Overclocking the memory is a little less involved since you don't have fine-tuned increments to play with. If you're running a DDR4 2400 kit, it's pretty much going to reach 2667 MHz, 2800, or 2933. It also may not be stable in an overclock at all, if you're unlucky. Once you set the speed and voltage in BIOS, you'll need to test stability with memtest. Open as many copies of memtest as you have threads. For a Ryzen 3, that's 4 cores, so 4 copies. If you had a Ryzen 7, you'd open 16 copies since there are 16 logical cores. The next step is to divvy up your system memory between the copies of memtest, but note that you need to look at available memory, not just your total installed. Open up Task Manager with Ctrl+Shift+Escape, go to the Performance tab, and look at your memory. Here I have 1.7 GB used out of 8 GB. That means I need to divide the 6.3 available between each one, or about 1500 MB each. For the last instance, however, just leave it as all unused RAM. That ensures that you don't go over or under your system memory. If you go over, the system will push memtest into the page file on your hard drive or SSD and dramatically increase the time it takes to run the test. If you go under, it won't be able to test all memory locations. Let memtest run until it reaches at least 200% coverage on all instances. If it passes without error, it means your overclock is stable. At that point, you can try the next faster speed or just leave your overclock as is. If it does find an error, it will immediately notify you and stop the test. Any errors at all indicate instability. You'll need to either lower your speed a notch or increase your voltage and test again. Once you've overclocked your CPU and memory and verified stability and temperatures, that's it. You're ready to start gaming with potentially huge performance gains. To get an idea of the performance difference, check out my Ryzen 3 1200 benchmark video in the card in the top right or through the link in the description. I'm throwing in a troubleshooting section since you'll probably encounter at least one of these issues. Issue 1. You set an overclock, the computer restarts, and then you have a blank screen. Fear not, you didn't break anything, it's just an unstable overclock. To get the computer back to stock clocks and voltages, you'll need to clear the CMOS. I covered it in detail earlier in the guide, but basically there are two pins on the motherboard that you'll need to short together for a few seconds to reset everything. If you don't have a jumper to short them, you can use a metal screwdriver or paperclip. Check your motherboard's manual for the clear CMOS entry. Issue 2. The computer is unstable, games are crashing, or the computer is randomly shutting off after overclocking. This could be caused by two things. 1. The overclock is simply unstable, or 2. Your CPU is hitting the temperature limit and throttling or shutting off. First, make sure that it's not a temperature issue by running Prime95 and monitoring the processor temperature and hardware monitor. If it's going above 85 or 90 degrees Celsius, it's probably throttling or shutting down to protect itself. You'll need to reduce the clock frequency, core voltage, or both, in order to bring it back down to safe levels. If temperature is not the issue, it means your overclock is unstable. If you have your CPU and RAM overclocked, first test stability with the CPU overclocked and the RAM at stock clocks and voltage. If it stops crashing, your memory overclock was the issue. If it's still crashing, your CPU overclock is at fault. Whether the problem lies with the RAM or CPU, you'll need to either reduce the clock frequency or increase the voltage on the offending component. Always carefully monitor temperatures when you increase voltage. Issue 3. After overclocking, your processor goes above 75 degrees, 80, or higher during stress testing. This one is easy. Your cooler is not strong enough for the power you're demanding from the CPU, so it's getting too hot. To fix this, lower your clock speed, or your voltage, or both, and your temperatures will go down. Issue 4. The processor is locked at 1.55 GHz no matter what you do in BIOS. This is an issue with the BIOS in many, many Ryzen motherboards, and most manufacturers have released BIOS updates that fix it. For the MSI B350M Gaming Pro, it was a glitch caused by setting a manual core voltage. You'll need to update to a beta BIOS release, linked to in the description. If you have a motherboard from another manufacturer, check if the latest BIOS from them fixes the issue. As a quick summary, here are the general guidelines for Ryzen 3 CPU and RAM overclocking. Your target CPU speed should be somewhere between 3.8 and 4.1 GHz. CPU voltage should be between 1.3 and 1.35 volts, unless you have an aftermarket cooler which might let you safely go up to 1.4 volts. RAM is less consistent, though most kits should be able to reach 2667 MHz. Faster RAM might hit 2800, 2933, or even higher speeds. RAM voltage should be set to 1.35 volts, and really only increase if you know what you're doing and have decent heatsinks on your memory. Whether you're on stock cooling, aftermarket air, or AIO liquid, the overclocking process is identical. The only real difference is how far you'll be able to take your clock speeds. Also, this same testing and verification process can be used on Intel processors. All the software and steps I mentioned in this video are applicable in any overclocking situation. The whole process these days is much easier than in the past, and overclocking has definitely gone from a niche hobby to just something that most PC gamers do. I hope this guide helps you get some extra performance from your hardware, and I wish you luck in the silicon lottery. So guys, if you liked this video, hit the like button. If you want to see more, hit subscribe. And if you have any questions I didn't answer in this guide, or you want to know how to start a flame war on Reddit, ask me in the comments below. Thanks for watching, I hope I helped, and I'll see you in the next video.